Hey there once again, YouTube. Just a few things to bring to you today. By the way, July 16th through 18th, there were more spasmodic tremor events in Hawaii. First off, if you want to know what spasmodic tremor is and how it relates to the volcanic activity that is ongoing underneath the Big Island of Hawaii, no volcanoes are erupting there yet, but Mauna Loa's, it's now at an advisory state. It's been for, I believe, about a month now. And I do feel Mauna Loa could be the next to erupt on the Big Island of Hawaii. And spasmodic tremor continues within the mantle plume. So if you want to learn about that, go to the description box below to the link that says, "What is spasmodic tremor?" And click that if you want. And also you can go to the link right below that, which will be for the July 16th through 18th spasmodic tremor events. And I show the usual seismic plots, and I also include seismic audio. I show helicorder plots, regular seismic plots, and I include the audio for all of these spasmodic tremor events. So you can check that out if you want. Again, a link is in the description box below for those two blog posts that I told you about. Number three, there's another link you'll see down there about what are spectrograms. I had a lot of viewers confused about what spectrograms are and how to read them. So a link will be in the description box below. It's one of my most recent videos on YouTube about what spectrogram plots are and what they actually show. And I have a lot of proof to back it up. So go check that out. Go check that video out if you wish. Now I have some activity to bring to you. Now on July 16th through 18th, again, there were spasmodic tremor events. However, it seems like there was another spasmodic tremor event this morning. Let's go to TRAD on the slopes of Mauna Loa. As you can see, in the past 24 hours, we did see yet another spasmodic tremor event. And again, I tell you about all the intricacies of spasmodic tremor in Hawaii if you go to the "What is spasmodic tremor?" blog post. Again, link in the description box below. TRAD, now let's go to a different seismic station just to make sure that's not surface noise. Yep, we see the same event right there. Let's go to KKUD. This was not the largest spasmodic tremor event ever seen, but it is one of the largest. It is near the top of the list. And notice that we see spasmodic tremor right here as well. Same exact time frame. Let's go to PPLD, closer to the epicenter. Spasmodic tremor, usually the epicenters themselves are usually in this area. Very deep, anywhere between 20 kilometers to 60 kilometers in depth. Can last anywhere from 10 minutes to an hour and 11 minutes. And can be somewhat strong. I doubt anyone would actually be able to feel these events, but you never know. Notice another spasmodic tremor event right there. Same one that we were seeing on the other stations. Go to PPLD right near the epicenter. Past 24 hours, and you see it right there as well. Let's take a look at this in the seismic program swarm just real quick from station TRAD. Here we are at seismic station TRAD. I don't know if you can hear in the background or not. My son is throwing a pretty big temper tantrum because it's bedtime, so, yeah. Moving on, so we do see a few earthquakes in the past few hours. Notice we had one right here, let's see here. Probably I'm going to say near Mauna Loa. I'm probably going to say around Mauna Loa somewhere. But here we see the spasmodic tremor event right here. Typical spasmodic tremor. Let's zoom all the way out to see the entire event. A few earthquakes in the beginning. Yeah, my son's freaking out. I don't know if you can hear that in the background or not. He does not like bedtime very much anymore. Especially after we got him a new bed. I mean, we just got him a new bed, a car's bed. I'm surprised he isn't obsessed with sleeping in it. But he will not go to bed. This spasmodic tremor event, I'm going to count it starting right about here, which was about 1400 UTC. And lasted until about, I'm going to say, 1445 or so. So about 45 minutes long, which is not the longest. And according to the amplitude count, it is not the strongest. But some of the spikes went up to about 819 amplitude count on TRAD. And this station is pretty far away from the epicenter. Again, these are occurring very deep within the mantle plume. Possibly showing magma recharge along the mantle plume conduit, leading to the volcanoes on the Big Island of Hawaii. But we see this is definitely a pretty strong one, guys. We've definitely seen some spasmodic tremor events in the past week or two have been pretty strong. Nothing as strong, though, as the January 23rd, 2019 spasmodic tremor events. Again, you can find resources in the links part in the description box below if you want to learn more about these events and how they are associated to volcanic activity on the Big Island of Hawaii. Now, moving on. Notice over here on the East Coast, which is currently experiencing a pretty strong heat wave right now, almost in the hundreds. I believe it's like 101 in Washington, D.C. right now or something like that. Let's go to terrain. Notice that we had, let's go zoom in. We had an earthquake in New York and Pennsylvania. Let's deal with the New York earthquake first. right over here. Let's go east of Lake Pleasant, New York, at magnitude 2.2 at 5 kilometers in depth. Let's take a look at the event page for this event just real fast. See how many people reported feeling it. Only 5 people reported feeling it. Yeah, that's not surprising because it's only a 2.2, but, you know, earthquakes don't really happen too much in New York, but they do get them every once in a while. It does happen, guys. So let's see. Whoops, my bad. Closest seismic station to this event is J59A in the N4 network. Let's take a look at this in the seismic program swarm just real quick. Here you have data obtained from J59A in the N4 network, 00 location code broadband vertical. Since it's a broadband vertical channel, I did add a 1 Hz high pass filter to get rid of those pesky background microseisms. Now this 2.2 near Lake Pleasant, New York, at 5 kilometers in depth, occurred on July 19, 2019 at 14:47:34 UTC. It took only a second or two to arrive on this station right here. At 14:47 UTC on the 19th, we do see an earthquake right here. Extremely peculiar. Now, if you were standing near that, wait a second. Let me do max frequency of the spectrogram. Let's change that, shall we? Let's go to 40. Will it allow us to go to 40 hertz? Wow. Okay. Whoops. Oh, come on. Okay, let's see if we can go all the way to 70 hertz. Will it let us go to 70? Nope, maximum is 50. But look at how high these frequencies are, guys. Look at this. Barely any low frequencies much at all. The main power of the event, let's go to the spectra plot. Oh, my bad. I gotta do 50 for the spectra plot as well. Okay, between 10 hertz and I'm gonna say about 24 hertz or so. But barely any lower frequencies at all. That is very strange, but that's not too strange. I have seen that a lot, primarily on the East Coast, though. I don't know why the East Coast sees much higher frequencies with their earthquakes than really anywhere else does. I mean, of course, everywhere else has very high frequencies, but usually we should see some strong low frequencies as well. I mean, really, we should. But for some reason, we don't see much at all. Really, except for right about here, we do see some little bit of lower frequencies right there, but that's just part of the earthquake itself. I don't know why it is so high. Going all the way up to 50 hertz, if this could record to 70 hertz, it'd probably still show some strength to 70 hertz. But the main power, again, is between about 8 hertz and 24 hertz or so, right there. So that's the earthquake in New York. Look at how strange it looked, guys. Look at that. Very, very long lasting for a simple high frequency 2.2. Now, I thought these were aftershocks right here. These look too emergent and much different than the earthquake itself. You notice there's the earthquake. There's something. There might be an earthquake, actually, an aftershock right here. I don't know, though. I don't know. The East Coast has some weird stuff going on sometimes, guys. Weird stuff. And again, 2.2 at 5 kilometers in depth near Lake Pleasant, New York. So not only did we see a magnitude 2.2 at 5 kilometers in depth up here in New York, but far to the southwest, about 2.5 hours later, in southeastern Pennsylvania, we did see another magnitude 2.2, except this one did occur at about 2 kilometers in depth. Let's go to the event page just real fast. How many people felt it? 298. Wow. And it's the same size as the New York event. In New York, only 5 people reported this. Same size earthquake down in Pennsylvania about 2.5 hours later. Saw 298 people report feeling it. Wow, that's a lot of people for a 2.2, guys. Let's go to phases. Arrival time. Closest station was PSBK in the PE network. Let's take a look at that in the seismic program swarm right now. Again, this earthquake occurred at 1711 UTC on July 19, 2019. Here you have PSBK in the PE network, -- location code broadband vertical. Since it's a broadband channel, I'm going to enable a 1 Hz high pass filter to the 8th power. And we see at about 1711, we see the earthquake right here. Notice very, very strong frequencies. Very strong frequencies of all frequencies, actually. Let's see how far the station goes up to. Let's do 50 Hz. You think it'll let us? 50 to 50. Yes, it'll let us go up to 50. The strong high frequencies go up to about, I'm going to say 26 hertz, kind of weaken out. And then we see it get a little bit stronger around 35 hertz. So these two earthquakes on the East Coast, if you were listening very closely, not to this video, but if you're listening very closely to the ground, you probably would have actually heard them a little bit. No joke. If an earthquake carries high enough frequency, it is possible to hear the actual earthquake itself. Yeah, It is very possible, and it is pretty strange. But we see, again, the magnitude 2.2 in Pennsylvania, right here. Very, very interesting, guys. Very interesting. Two earthquakes on the East Coast within just a few hours, within about 2.5 hours or so of each other. So that's very intriguing, my people. Why do you think that is? Just as the heat is coming in. So they got heat, and now they got earthquakes. But they're only 2.2 earthquakes, so nothing too crazy there. Now, let's move on just real quick. Now, here we are back at earthquake.usgs.gov. There's a magnitude 5.3 in Greece, guys. It says north-north, 3 kilometers north-northwest of Magula, Greece. But Athens, Greece is right in this location here. Let me turn on terrain real quick. Athens is right there. So very close to the capital of Greece. Got hit by a magnitude 5.3 earthquake. Only 477 people reported to USGS that they felt this event. But since USGS is a United States federal institution, not that many people in Greece probably would report to USGS. So it's likely thousands, if not tens of thousands of people actually did feel this event, because they probably likely reported to their local earthquake authority. Here's the moment tensor right there. Scrolling down. No explanation is given. It's estimated economic losses, is in the yellow. Same with fatalities, but I don't think anybody died from this earthquake, but let's check out one of the articles about it just real quick. Now, here we do have on BBC.com, buildings collapse as powerful tremor shakes Athens. A strong earthquake has shaken the Greek capital of Athens, knocking out phone networks and power in parts of the city. And let's see if this video will work or not. I don't know if it will. Come on, buddy. It's taking a little while. There we go. Wow, look at that. It's pretty powerful, and they probably don't have that many earthquake codes that we do here in the United States as of late. Yeah, a lot of buildings in the past 10 years have been retrofitted with a lot of earthquake codes, so really, if you live in a new building, it should withstand a good 5.3, but maybe not in Greece. I don't know. They have a lot of old buildings there, especially in Athens. The 5.1 magnitude earthquake, which, by the way, the local earthquake association said that it was a 5.1. USGS, come on, says it's a 5.3. So that right there dispels the theories that they always downgrade earthquakes, because this is showing 0.2 larger than what the local earthquake authority is saying it is. USGS says it's a 5.3. Greece says it's a 5.1. And Athenians ran out into the streets as the city shook for 15 seconds. There were no reports of serious injuries, but several aftershocks have been felt, and two buildings have collapsed. The strongest aftershock had a magnitude of 4.3, almost an hour after the initial quake hit at 1413, which would be 1113 GMT. Remember, GMT is also UTC. Seismologists warned there could be more. Possibly four shocks? Maybe, maybe not. The earthquake was felt particularly strong in the center of Athens, where people stood in the streets after evacuating from tall buildings. Everyone was terrified, you know, people were freaking out, yeah. But it was a pretty intense quake, everyone was scared, we were all very afraid, but, you know, personally, I would kind of enjoy going through a 5.3 earthquake. I was excited when the 4.6 hit Monroe, Washington just last week, guys. I got up, I thought, I was a little scared just for a few seconds, thinking that it was going to be like a magnitude 8 or, you know, something crazy. But, you know, eventually the shaking started to die down a little bit. I was like, woo! Oh, yeah! Get the blood pumping! Woohoo! So we're going to take a look at the magnitude 5.3 in Greece just real quick from the closest reported seismic station to the epicenter, which would be ITM in the HL network, broadband vertical --- location code. 27 seconds to arrive on the station, so this station is somewhat far away from the epicenter, but we still will get a good look at the earthquake itself. Here we are in the seismic program swarm with data taken from station ITM in the HL network --- location code. Broadband vertical. Since it's a broadband station, I'm going to set a 1 Hz high pass filter to the 8th power. Go to the spectrogram first off, because that's my favorite to use. We see this event right here, which is the magnitude 5.3 that first struck Athens, Greece around 1113 UTC. Now, the frequencies of this earthquake are pretty low, but remember, frequencies do attenuate with distance, meaning that they do sort of drop with distance, but this station really isn't that far away. It only took about 27 seconds for this earthquake to appear on here. So I don't know why the frequencies are so low, but it could have to do with distance once again. There's the, again, magnitude 5.3. Let's check out the dominant frequencies in the spectra plot. Yeah, pretty low, guys. Starting at the frequency filter of 1 Hz and dying down at about 3 Hz or so, 3.5 Hz. going forward. You see, it was pretty calm. Maybe a few aftershocks here and there. You could definitely tell there were a few aftershocks. Very small aftershocks afterwards. And then it built up to this aftershock right here. Probably around a 3.5 or so. And moving forward, see a few more aftershocks. And then later on, we see, boom, this is the magnitude 4.3, which people did feel as well. So Athens, Greece, getting hit by a good amount of earthquakes, guys. Good amount of earthquakes. Looking down here, I'm not really seeing too many more aftershocks, but they likely will continue for a little while, because this is a moderate to large earthquake, especially when two buildings collapsed, that is for sure. More aftershocks here. So, again, they said the shaking may not be over. There could be more earthquakes coming, maybe even a larger one. It is always possible that large earthquakes like these could be foreshocks, but really, you never know until the main shock happens. Just like in California. They thought the 6.4 and other aftershocks were just aftershocks, right? Or they thought it was a main shock and aftershock. But no, all of them were foreshocks to the magnitude 7.1 in California. So that's it for Greece right now. Over here at Yellowstone Caldera in northwest Wyoming, it's been pretty boring lately. But today, finally, we had a somewhat interesting earthquake swarm, with the largest being the most recent, 2.1 at 8.4 kilometers in depth. None of these were reportedly felt. Zoom in. We did see one of the earthquakes struck far to the north. Norris is right here. So just to, right near the epicenter, the location of seismic station YHH, we did see a 1.6 at 7.1 kilometers in depth. But right down here near the lower geyser basin, right here, notice lower geyser basin, upper geyser basin. Notice we did see a somewhat of an interesting swarm on a linear path from about, about east-southeast to about west-northwest in this diagonal formation right here. Let's turn on the U.S. faults, see if there's any faults right at this location. Not looking like it, but of course there always could be, just saying. Let's see what the closest seismic station was to the earthquake in the epicenter, so we can get a good look at this swarm just real quick. Go to origin, go to phases, arrival time. Looks like borehole 207 in the PB network. Let's take a look at that now in the seismic program swarm. Here we are, borehole 207 in the PB network, --, location code, short period vertical. On the 19th right here, zooming forward, we do see some earthquakes, and we do see them right here. Notice not everything you see in a borehole is seismic. I do have to say, if you ever think you find something seismic, always correlate it with the nearest seismic station. Even a negative magnitude quake can show up on multiple stations around Yellowstone Caldera, especially if it's occurring in a more dense part of the network. But I'm just saying, we do see some earthquakes. Let's zoom out with the spectrogram, shall we? We see four of them occurring within about a minute and a half right here. See another one right there. Another one right here. Very interesting quake right here. Look at this. Almost looks like an emergent surface event, but that is not a surface event. Those are quakes, very teeny, teeny, tiny quakes leading up to this earthquake right here. Very intriguing, guys. Very, very intriguing. So not really a rapid fire swarm, but almost. Almost a rapid fire swarm. And you know how I love those rapid fire swarms at Yellowstone, guys. Those are my favorite swarms to analyze. Very odd looking P wave on this earthquake right here. Look at that. Let me zoom back into that. Look at that P wave, guys. Look at this. Almost looks like the deep, deep earthquakes that occur in Hawaii from time to time. Very, very weird. Very odd. See another earthquake right here. And we see another earthquake right there. So nothing too, too crazy. We did see a few. Two earthquakes right there, actually. I believe this was the 2.1 they were reporting, I believe. Let's see, 1954 UTC. 1954 UTC, 2.1 at 8.4 kilometers in depth. And I believe that was the last one reported for the Yellowstone area. But regardless, we do see another earthquake right here, likely a 2.0, maybe down to 1.8 or 1.7. And then we do see some tiny aftershocks right here, probably a 0.5, 0.8 right there. Definitely a 0.3 probably. And a few other teeny tiny earthquakes right there. So Yellowstone did see a tiny, tiny swarm today, but maybe more is on the way, maybe not. I don't know. Hope you guys have a great day. Let's see if anything occurred while I was recording. Remember, I always got to check right before. Okay, nothing too crazy. Again, don't forget to check the description box below for the three links. The links to what is a spasmodic tremor, and the recent spasmodic tremor events from July 16th through July 18th, and how to read a spectrogram, what spectrograms are, and what the misconceptions and misinformation is versus the truth. I hope you guys have a great day. Always test everything out for yourself. Don't take my word for it or another YouTuber's word for it or even the professional's word for it 100%. Always do some digging on your own. It's actually not that hard to do some digging on your own either. You just have to put your mind to it and put your heart to it. Hope you guys have a great day. God bless, and I'll see you later.